I want to say that I was in love at first sight, but I actually first heard about Nemertians in a lecture. I thought they were fascinating animals with a unique mode of life and a unique body plan. And at the time, their relationship to other animals was not entirely clear. On top of it, not very many people studied Nemertians. So I thought, I'll take the job. Nemertians, or ribbon worms, are beautiful and graceful marine animals. I love the way they move, slowly gliding over the surface using the cilia of their epidermis. Some species have striking patterns and colors. Others are plain, but still elegant. There are about 1,300 described species of Nemertians in the world, but likely at least as many undescribed species. Most species of Nemertians are marine and benthic. A few are freshwater or terrestrial, and one group is holopelagic. Nemertians as a phylum are characterized by an reversible proboscis, which normally lies inside a fluid-filled cavity called the rhynchocele. They use their proboscis to attack their prey, such as other worms. Toxic secretions of the proboscis epithelium paralyze the prey, and then the Nemertian swallows it whole. This earned Nemertians a nickname, pythons of the sea. Nemertians come in a variety of shapes and sizes, from a few millimeters long to several meters long. The blue whale may be the largest living animal on Earth, but the title of the longest living animal on Earth goes to a Nemertian called Linnaeus longissimus. One individual, collected in England in 1864, measured 55 meters, or approximately 180 feet long. Nemertians are ecologically important as top predators in marine ecosystems, but very few things eat Nemertians, because they secrete copious amounts of unpalatable or downright toxic mucus. A variety of toxins have been identified from Nemertians, including tetrodotoxin and anabasine. Anabasine and its derivatives have shown promise in treating conditions like schizophrenia and Alzheimer's disease. One group of Nemertians adapted to feed on eggs of decapod crustaceans, including some commercially important species such as king crab, blue crab, American lobster, and Dungeness crab. The numbers of worms on a crab can reach an astonishing number of thousands of worms per individual. Perhaps the most interesting thing about the Nemertians is their unusual development. The juvenile worm develops inside the larval body from a series of isolated rudiments called imaginal discs. The imaginal discs grow and fuse around the larval gut. Once the juvenile body is complete, the larva undergoes catastrophic metamorphosis in which the juvenile erupts through the larval body and devours the larva. In this video, you can see the juvenile worm inside the semi-transparent larval body. The juvenile moves around inside the little membrane decorated with pigment spots called the amnion. The worm has just ruptured the amnion, and now it's trying to poke its head out, and it has to still rupture the very thin larval epidermis. Now the head is outside, and you can see the shimmering of the cilia on the surface of the worm. All the while the larva is moving around. Now, to successfully metamorphose, most juveniles begin to back out of the larva while swallowing the larval tissues. The mouth is a little ways from the anterior tip of the juvenile, and now you can see the ciliated band of the larva and the pigment spots, which used to decorate the amniotic membrane, disappear into the gut of the juvenile. Now the apical organ of the larva disappears into the mouth, and now you can see the remaining part of the larval body and the pigment granules being swallowed by the juvenile. Now it's a little worm, a little benthic worm, which has just completed its first meal of its own larval body. So why do I study Nemertians? As humans, we all have different abilities and different talents. I'm good at studying Nemertians and I like Nemertians, so I feel that it is my calling in life to learn about these organisms, to educate and inspire others.